Good afternoon and good evening. Welcome to today's Gaelic Schools debate, which is broadcast live in Reading and Gael from the Parliament here in Edinburgh. This is also being broadcast live online at scottishparliament.tv, and if you then select Committee Room 2. I'm Alistair Fraser and I am chair tonight for this debate. Before that, we will get we'll be welcomed by Deputy Residing Officer for the Parliament. Please welcome John Scott. Good evening and welcome to the Scottish Parliament. Thank you, John Scott, Deputy Presiding Officer of the Parliament. Now we have to thank the committee who work so hard organising this debate each year. The BT Alapa debate won the event of the year at last week's Gaelic Awards in Glasgow. Congratulations to them. This year we saw 22 teams competing, representing 17 schools from throughout Scotland. The semi-finals were held last night in the Scottish Storytelling Centre here in Edinburgh. And what a challenge the judges have tonight. Getting through to tonight's final, please welcome our first team, the Nicolson Institute C, Mairi MacLennan and Callum Nicolson. And from Dingwall Academy A, please welcome Ella Scarr and Megan Dale. Congratulations to you all for reaching this stage. Now I would like to welcome all of you who are listening on Radio Ningale on radio, and also those present here tonight in the Scottish Parliament. And also I'd like to welcome our judges tonight. First of all, next to me here is Maggie Cunningham. Maggie lives in Plockton and she is chair of MG Alape. Maggie spent almost 20 years at the BBC, and many of those years were spent in upper management. Along with Maggie is Joe MacDonald. Joe's been a judge here at the final a couple of times, and she also spent many years at the BBC, also in upper management in the Gaelic department. And beside them is Angus MacDonald. You'll be familiar with Angus from his news presenting on BBC Alapa, both on radio and television. And if he's not to be found in the newsroom in Stornoway, you'll probably find him on his croft in Swardle and Point. So please welcome our judges. I'd also like to welcome and thank our representatives from BT Scotland who are here tonight. They, along with many other groups, support the Gaelic schools debate. Also thanks to Cónaí Éireann Siar, BBC Alapa, MG Alapa, Cumann na Gaelic, Prosaic na Gealtáin, Bord na Gaelic and the MRG group. And finally tonight I'd like to welcome Iona McCritchie, who is a senior producer at BBC Alapa's news department. She has had a busy year, been involved in broadcasting the referendum, and the debate is nothing new for Iona. She was in the team that won this in 1999. Please welcome Iona. That wasn't yesterday. And now some information about the rules of debate and the format of this evening. Each speaker from each team will have 6 minutes. First of all, the first speaker will speak for the recommendation, for the argument for, and then there'll be a speaker against. The second speaker from each team will then have 5 minutes, and as usual, we'll be keeping a close eye on the time. If you're running out of time, that is the noise you will hear. When you run out of time, this is the sound you'll hear. You will be penalised if you run over, and points will be taken away. Each team will then get 5 minutes to question the opposition with a bell to mark the end of that time. And one speaker from each team will then get between a minute and 2 minutes to round up. I think that's enough from me. We'll now start tonight's debate. And our subject tonight, in the world of media, the Gaels have nothing to learn from the Lowlanders. I'll say that again. In the world of media, the Gaels have nothing to learn from Lowlanders. So we begin with the Nicolson Institute C, who are for this argument. Please welcome Mairi MacLennan. We want to be clear about the difference between the Gaelic world of media and the English world. In the last census, one out of 1% understand Gaelic. In the world of English, we have about 50 million speakers in this country. Gaelic media gets 13 million. English media gets the billions. From that point of view, we do not see that the Gaels have anything to learn from the Lowlanders. Before we look at Gaels and the Lowlanders, we have to look at, first of all, what we mean by the word media. Now, that means any way in which you communicate, whether that be written, whether it be viewed or listened to. Now, for this debate, we take media to mean radio, TV and newspapers. And when you think of English media, what do you think of? Arguments, hacking, arguments between commercial companies and sensationalism. And when you search the BBC in Google, it's scandals that appear. They have an insane amount of money, and they will be taken to court if they do anything wrong. And these laws have had to be amended recently because of the carry-on that they've had. And that has affected the freedom that people have had to communicate publicly. And do you want the Gaels who are involved in media to be just like them? No, you don't. The Lowlanders, they could learn a lot from the Highlanders, from the Gaels. The Gaels are very creative with the funding that they receive. They create an awful lot with very small budgets. There are no other broadcasters in the United Kingdom which create as many programmes from as little funding. If you think about Macher or Kruhusuaker, Yorpe or Bannon, these dramas, the drama Bannon costs a fraction of what an English drama costs. The Gaelic programmes have to be as good or better than the English programmes. The BBC receive a fortune every year. S4C in Wales receives over 100 million each year. You have to watch BBC Alapa for 15. You have to watch BBC Alapa for 15 minutes to be classified as a viewer of BBC Alapa, but in Wales you only have to watch for 3 minutes to be classified as a viewer. There are 10 times as many Welsh speakers as there are Gaelic speakers. So that means that there are more of them who watch their programmes. The second point, the Gaelic broadcasters have a particular responsibility to promote the language, something that Lowlanders do not have. It's very difficult to judge the success of a minority language broadcaster by looking at the viewing figures. If they start to compare themselves to the English media, then it makes it very difficult when the promotion and the expansion of the language is vital. So the Gaels don't see everything through commercial eyes. It is excellent that there's no advertising on BBC Alapa which break up the programmes. If Cunhach Mór appeared in the middle of Bannon trying to sell you a tin of links, or Chessy Lexi modelling spandex. Another important point, Gaelic broadcasting does not need a watershed either. The Gaels don't need or require misbehaviour or bad language to attract them to the TV programmes. They are attracted without these things. Do you think the Gaels would appreciate the likes of Russell Brand, Jonathan Ross, with their bad language? No, they wouldn't. So it is the Lowlanders that should learn from the Gaels. Now, if you think about the Gaels who've reached the higher levels in broadcasting, Finlay J and Alec MacDonald. Now, I've mentioned TV and radio, but Callum will talk about the newspapers. The English media how's the phrase it here, Norman MacLeod on STV. And Tony Kearney, they are representing programmes in English. Look at how the Lowlanders want to listen to the Gaels, but you don't see it the other way around. These are Gaels who have abilities as good or better than the Lowlanders, and Callum will follow that up. Thank you. Sorry, I can't quite hear it properly because I meant to have a feed, but I've just got to have the door open. Thank you very much, Mairi MacLennan there. And against the motion from Dingwall Academy A, please welcome Ella Scarr. Thank you for everybody assisting me last night, and the medical assistant I got from Google. I'm okay now, and hopefully I'll get through the next 6 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, the Gaels haven't been far behind the Lowlanders in the last few years, but it's clear now that they are well behind. We have had newspapers in Gaelic in the past. We've had them since the 19th century. But we do not have a newspaper now anymore. Now, even though we were here 2 years ago talking about the day of the newspaper being over, they are the foundation upon which media has been built. We used to have the Gaelic newspaper, but unfortunately the Gaelic is no longer. But we shouldn't be disappointed about that. Just this Monday a new newspaper was released, the National. So the Gaels should learn from this. Who knows, that we might have a new Gaelic very soon. The new Gaelic channel BBC Alapa was established in 2008, and what confidence it gave us that we were deserving of our own channel. Before that, we only had a very small number of programmes on TV, quite often in the small hours. And no wonder Gaelic was reducing. People didn't have the skills that they needed. We now have the channel, and we're delighted with that. But if it wasn't for the Lowlanders, for those in the BBC in particular, and the abilities that they have, we wouldn't be able to run the channel. It is the skills and the abilities of the Lowlanders that allow us to run BBC Alapa and Radio Na Gael. It's an excellent thing that we get support for the Gaelic. I'm delighted to say, though, that we are seeing more and more Highland names appearing in the credits at the end of programmes, and this is showing progress in terms of the skills and experience that Gaels have with support from the Lowlanders. We should all learn from one another. A word now about the types of programmes that are to be seen on BBC Alapa. And there's a wide range of programmes available, between drama, educational programme, children's programmes, documentary, arts, sports. It's the mix of programmes that we would expect from the channel. And it is looking at the programmes that others have produced over the years, it is reasonable to think that Gaels would follow the format that other channels have had previously. We learned from the Lowlanders like that. But we only get 6 or 7 hours each day. We should learn from the Lowlanders and broadcast programmes throughout the day. The programmes, the documentaries on BBC Alapa are enjoyable. In social studies, geography and history, they're very useful. But many of these programmes are bought in from other channels elsewhere, like National Geographic. And then they're dubbed into Gaelic. So BBC Alapa wouldn't be able to show us these interesting programmes if it wasn't for the non-Gaels creating them. but it is a new channel, and there are more and more Gaelic programmes, and the more programmes that are appearing with Gaels in them show us that we are learning new skills and experience from the non-Gaels. Now, drama might be one of the biggest holes that there has been. Everybody enjoys drama. Who doesn't watch EastEnders, or Coronation Street? We used to have Macher years ago, and everybody enjoyed it. But the thing is, the writers were writing in English to begin with, and then were translated into Gaelic. They were non-Gaels who were behind it to begin with. They didn't have any Gaelic. The writers were non-Gaels as well. And when the Gaels started writing it, the viewing numbers dropped. So it was the non-Gaels that were making it good. So finally, now we have a drama on BBC All Up at Bannon, and we really enjoyed seeing this in Gaelic. And the technical team and the writing team were all Gaels, and that shows that we've learned from a lot since the time of Macher. But interestingly enough, it's the production team that produced the in-betweeners that create this programme. So it's the non-Gaels again who are showing us how to do it. So we've learned a lot from the non-Gaels. There are lots of repeats, the one BBC All Up. But before I leave, it's good to learn from others. That's my main point. Thank you. Ella Scarr there. And now our second speaker from each team. And they have 5 minutes each. So, for the argument, first of all, from Nicolson Institute C, please welcome Callum Nicolson. Friends, as you heard from Mairi, we are for the argument that the Gaels have nothing to learn from the non-Gaels in the world of media. It's impossible to imagine that the other team could even think about saying that the Gaels could learn anything from the non-Gaels. As Mairi has already shown you, there is no section of media where Gaelic gets more money than the English. The recommendation that we would have is, when are the Gaels going to show the non-Gaels how they should be running media? There's no doubt that the Gaels have made a lot of progress in the world of media. All you have to do is listen to the radio, TV, or any newspaper, and you'll see how Gaels have impacted elsewhere. Look at BBC All Up and how much they create and do for Gaelic, as Mairi has shown us. If you look at BBC Radio and Gael, in 2010 they won the Radio Station of the Year against other stations such as Radio Scotland, Radio 2 and Radio Wales. People had to strive for years to reach where we are today in Gaelic media. We had to show that we were better than the non-Gaels. And Gaels today are running the BBC in Scotland, like Donalda McKinnon and Ken Macquarie. Now that is progress for you, and it proves that the Gaels, that if we are given the opportunity, we are as good and in many ways better than the non-Gaels. Now, Mairi spoke about TV and radio, but there are Gaels also at high level in newspapers. We look at Torkel Crichton from the Isle of Lewis. He started at the West Highland Free Press, and he is now editor. He is now an editor at the Daily Record, based in London. Now, a couple of months ago, Angus MacLeod passed away, and He had been raised in Plasterfield outside Stornoway, and he was the Scottish editor of the Times. So there are two examples of two normal Gaels who reached a very high level. Now, Doctor Who is seen as one of the prime programmes on the BBC. There's Douglas McKinnon, I think, from the Isle of Skye, who works in that. So the non-Gaels now take the talent from the Gaelic world to supplement the English world. This is proof once again that there's nothing for the Gaels to learn from the non-Gaels. While we're talking about telly, what about the programme Yorpe? It is the only programme that looks at Europe that's available in anywhere in Britain. That programme's been running for over 20 years now, winning national and international awards, proving that it is a special programme. Again, Gaels ahead of everyone else and producing programmes that are unavailable in any other language in this country. There are plenty of stars from the Highlands who started off in Gaelic. We have Michael Buchanan, who is at a high level in the BBC, and there's not that long since he was working at the BBC World Service. And also you've got the likes of Julie Fowlis from North Uist, who was singing in Gaelic on the film Brave. And she is now proving herself at the level of Hollywood. And she has just been awarded to her services for services Scottish music, the first Gael to receive such an award. And if you compare her to the stars that the non-Gaels have, Rupert Murdoch, Rebecca Brooks, Piers Morgan and Russell Brand, they have brought a bad name to the industry. They don't care about the impact they have on people. Friends, what on earth do the Gaels have to learn from the non-Gaels? Not a thing. Thank you. Thank you very much, Callum Nicolson there. And now, the final argument from Dingwall Academy A. Please welcome Megan Dale. Chair, ladies and gentlemen. Ella started her discussion by looking at the history of Gaelic media, and I started thinking that the Gaelic has been like many other newspapers and fell away, but we're falling behind now with Gaelic media, and media has changed a lot. At one time TV was a new exciting thing, but now it is the internet and social media which have priority. Social media gives Gaels the opportunity to broadcast themselves and promote Gaelic. And we should be taking these opportunities and taking advantage of these networks that have been created. A few years ago they tried to produce mygaelic.com for Gaels. That was thousands of pounds were spent on that years ago, but nobody wanted to use it because we had Twitter, Facebook and MySpace, and we used that. People were just writing in Gaelic and broadcasting there. But today we see more and more Gaelic appearing online on Facebook and on Twitter. And there are groups on Facebook that broadcast a lot. And we are thankful for the people who created these networks for us. And we see how other minority languages use these national, international networks. And this shows that we are learning from the non-Gaels, and that's a good thing. As part of the social media week that happened 2 years ago, Gaels debated where Gaelic stood in social media, and a question was asked, should apps and programs in Gaelic be created? And they were unanimous that it was better to use existing networks like Facebook and Twitter instead of creating a new network. So that shows again that we're learning from the non-Gaels. It's no good to create a box for ourselves that's just got Gaels in it. We have to bring people in from numerous places and show them the skills that we have and the things that already work. In the 19th century, Karl Marx said that workers should take the opportunities that they had. Now, that we are now suggesting that minority languages keep an eye on what is happening throughout the world and take control of the means of communication. One way of doing that, and a way that's been done effectively in the UK and in other countries, is crowdfunding. So this means that people are creating newspapers or digital channels with money and funding coming from the people who are going to be using it. So wingsoverscotland.com is an example, a website that was promoting the yes side in the referendum. They saw that there was an opportunity for a yes side in the debate for the referendum, and that website now attracts a lot of people. Gaels can learn from that and think and look at getting funding for a YouTube channel or something like that. That would be a good thing. It's a lot easier to do something like crowdfunding because it gives people the opportunity to control their broadcasting. And something else that we have seen is that the BBC control the voice of the Gaels too much, BBC Alapa and Radio Ningale, and that maybe restricts the output that we hear. We should use social media and look at international examples, and this will help a lot on how Gaels are seen internationally. We can also look at it's not good to put people in a box of Gael or non-Gael, and if we've only got 60,000 people who speak Gaelic, we have to look out with the outer box, not just within this box. And there's nothing that we will learn from the non-Gaels. Thank you. Thank you, Megan Dale, there. And now is the opportunity to question each other and to remind you of tonight's subject. In the world of media, the Gaels have nothing to learn from the Lowlanders or the non-Gaels. So first of all, for this, the Nicolson C. You said that BBC Alba doesn't broadcast throughout the day. But if you had the budget that BBC Alba has, if you give another channel that budget, 13.8 million, what kind of programmes would you then get from that? Well, if you're talking about money, why not look at the crowdfunding that we were talking about and then create more programmes? They don't have enough just now. But do you think about the budget they've got? You can't do that much with such a small budget. You were saying that there weren't enough programmes to be broadcast all day, but how are they going to do that with such a small budget? If you look at EastEnders, which spends 30 million a year, what we're saying is that they should use things like crowdfunding and social media to attract more funding. Why aren't the Gaels using that? And when the programmes are more successful, that attracts more funding. And that's how it works. because if they're not successful, then they don't attract any funding and they stop. Wasn't Bannon successful? And Yorpa. That's won national and international awards. But there still aren't enough people watching it. I had a tape of I recorded Gruzuokar and I wasted it ran out watching it every day. Yeah, that may be the case, but still not enough people are watching. Yes, 500,000 people are watching it. But not every programme on in Gaelic media is like that. You need more funding. You need more funding so you have more successful programmes. And remember, lots of these programmes, remember a lot of these programmes on BBC Alapa have been bought in from elsewhere. English programmes do that as well. You think about Friends, How I Met Your Mother, all these programmes are bought in. Doesn't that happen everywhere? But the Gaels buy in from the non-Gaels and learn from the non-Gaels. You want to be on the side of the non-Gaels. Do you think these watersheds are a good thing then? We didn't say we're on the side of the non-Gaels. We're just saying it's a good thing that we learn from them. Why is it good then to learn from people who use bad language after the watershed? The Gaels don't have to learn everything that the non-Gaels use, but maybe just the parts that make their programmes so successful. Who watches television at 5 o'clock instead of 10 o'clock? Most people watch at about 9, 10 o'clock. And that is when bad language and it was on TV. You know, and the only bad language you get in Gaelic is when Dan Murray talks to Cuneach Mór. Not every programme has bad language. That's not how it is at all. There are programmes which are fine. Wouldn't it be more effective for us to learn from people like TG Cahill in Ireland, who are developing their own channel with their own minority language instead of learning from the Lowlanders? We've been to Connemara to their studios there. A small budget like we have. Shouldn't we learn from people like that? Well, why not learn from the non-Gaels, the Lowlanders as well? But they have billions of pounds. The BBC has a massive budget. You look at David Attenborough when he goes off to Africa, Australia the next day. BBC Alabama doesn't have budgets like that. So shouldn't we learn from people who have similar experience to ourselves? That's your time run out for the Nicolson there, and the opportunity now for Dingwall Academy A. We found five programmes on Soil Show on BBC Alapa. When we read about them, they were international programmes translated into Gaelic. And BBC Alapa, they are trying to work with the budget that they have. If they had more, they could create more of their own programmes. And like I said, the non-Gaels do that as well. They buy programmes from other countries. If they had a bigger budget, they'd be better. But if they use things like social media, but social media is good for things like crowdfunding. Gaels have to help themselves. Now you've said that you said that you don't receive enough funding. And it's good that we don't have advertising, but advertising brings in money. So why not have more advertising and then bring in more funding? There you go. As I said, if you want to see Chessy Lexi in spandex, but as I said, that gives you time to go make a cup of tea. You don't have to watch them. But it gives you more money, and then you're able to create better programs. With the skills and technology of the non-Gaels, how could the Gaels survive? Are you saying that the Gaels aren't capable enough to run their own technology? We're saying that the non-Gaels technology is working, and we use what they've given us. Now, you've said that they've got more money, they've got better technology. Then why don't we learn how to make better programs from them and then get more funding? Anybody who works in media knows how to do their own job. People in BBC Gallipa know just as well how to work a camera as those who are down in London. I know if you want to get training from the BBC, you get the same training, you get your training centrally and then we'll go to BBC Gallipa maybe. You were talking about doing between us, isn't he based in Skye? But he has come from the non-Gael world. Do you not think it's better to learn from the non-Gaels? And to copy them and create more programs? Do you not think that everybody should help each other? We can look at how successful non-Gael media has been. And attract that into our own world. That isn't saying that Gaelic broadcasting is bad, but what we're saying is that it'll be better if we learn from others. We think, as we said, it'll be better to maybe learn from somebody like TGK here in Ireland. They have a budget similar to us, and they have a minority language like us. Look at the attraction in BBC Gaelic, and programmes are shown, and they attract people up to the Highlands and Islands. In the 500,000 out of the 500,000 who watch BBC Gaelic each week, 9 out of 10. Don't have Gaelic. BBC Gaelic is excellent at attracting non-Gaels into watching. But you're still buying programmes from the non-Gaels. And you're learning these skills from the non-Gaels. And that improves the channel. Does that not improve the channel? Do you agree? No. Thank you very much. It is now time for our closing arguments. A speaker from each team will have between 1 and 2 minutes to do so. First of all, for the argument, Mairi MacLennan from the Nicolson Institute. See you. As we discussed there, you said that it was the technology of the non-Gaels that leaves BBC Gaelic being so successful. But are you trying to say that there are no Gaels that could do that? I don't really understand technology myself, but I don't represent everybody in the Highlands. Now, you've... also said that BBC Alba doesn't have enough programmes on, but the budget means that they have to work within those restrictions. And with the budget they've got, they're doing fantastically well. And they attract a wide variety of people. 90% of the viewers don't have Gaelic. So 90% of 500,000 watch have no Gaelic. But these statistics are important. And they prove our argument that with a budget so small, they've done so well. Now, you've also said that the Gaels are falling behind, but we have proven that the Gaelic media is excelling. Now, we don't have to learn anything from the Gaels, from the non-Gaels, but we now attract the non-Gaels into our culture and language. Bit by bit, the Gaels are doing what they struggle to do with the Claymore, and others have peace with the non-Gaels. Thank you, Mairi. And against the argument from Dingwall Academy, Megan Dale. Think about BBC Alapa and the programmes that are being coming from the non-Gaels, like the Gruffle One, Wallace and Gromit. Now, we've spoken about advertising, and we're fortunate that we have the advertising in the Lowland telly. But these adverts bring in so much money. If you want more money, you have to accept advertising. And while I'm talking about money, if they want more money, why not look at crowdfunding, as I explained? And that will be Gaels funding the Gaels. And nobody would then complain about Gaelic getting too much money. As Ella told you, it was non-Gaels that wrote Macher, and when they left, the programme wasn't as successful. And we've spoken about how Gaels have reached high levels in the BBC, but that is within a non-Gael system. It's silly to say that there's nothing we can learn from the non-Gaels in media. Why else do we learn? We go to school to learn. And we don't say, oh, I've learnt enough, I don't need to learn anymore. We always need to learn more, and it will help us. We only have 60,000 Gaelic speakers, so we need support. And it's dangerous to put ourselves in this box with a label on it. We have an awful lot to learn from the non-Gaels. We're always learning, and we'll continue to learn, but that's not bad. Thank you. Thank you, Megan Dale. And that is the debate over. And congratulations on you all. You'll now have the chance to take a breather. I'm going to ask the judges to leave the room to make their decisions. And while Maggie, Joe and Angus leave, we will listen to some of the debates from last night that were held in the semi-finals, that were held in the Scottish Storytelling Centre. Nicolson C were debating against Nicolson Institute A. And the subject, politics needs more characters and not those who have gone through Eton. In the second debate, James Gillespie High School were against Dingwall Academy A. And their argument was, it's a good thing that the internet gives us freedom to debate with each other, and here is how they got on, and I'm not going to translate this, but apologies for the delay in returning to us while we were listening to the semi-finals there. But now we're back at the final of the BT All-Upper debate, coming to you live from the Scottish Parliament. I'd like to welcome Liz Turner, who is here representing BBC BT Scotland. And I'm delighted to say that our judges are back. I'm now going to ask Angus MacDonald to take us through to the prizes. Thank you, Alistair. And thank you to the Scottish Parliament as well for their welcome here tonight. We've enjoyed the evening here. We've listened to a great debate with a very strong debate, well researched, very well informed. They went international in the examples that they gave us. And in both teams, each speaker raised points from the other side, and they gave us some interesting examples. And you recognise that they believed in their arguments, or at least they convinced us that they believed in their arguments. I think that was very important as well. The closing statements were very strong, but when it came down to the ones and twos, it was in the questioning that we made the difference. And one team was stronger in asking the questions. They were asking very difficult questions, and they were sticking to them. And the other team were maybe not answering the questions that were asked. No, it wasn't an easy decision, but in the end, we decided that Dingwall Academy have won this year. And Liz Turner from BT Scotland is handing over the prize just now. I also have to say that we've been debating the Speaker of the Year, and throughout the whole competition from the first round, we decided that Megan Dale is the Speaker of the Year, and she gets the BBC's. And she will receive that from Liz Turner from BBC BT Scotland. And now to hand over the BBC's shield to the best speaker. Please welcome Eoin McCritchie. Thank you, Alistair. You'll be delighted to hear that I've been on the phone to Ofcom, and we haven't broken any watershed rules by discussing Chessie Lexi and spandex. So you're okay, you're off the hook with that. I'm delighted to be here tonight to award this prize to Megan. I've enjoyed the evening and I enjoyed the debate as well. I have quite a strong connection with this building. I've been working here for the past year as a as a political correspondent, I'd like to say that every debate I listened to was as lively and as interesting and as tonight's debate. Well, I'll say it was anyway. I've also got quite a strong tie with this debate now. As Alistair said, we won this in he said 1992, it was actually 1999. I won the prize, not with my own school, but when somebody from the Nicolson got sick on the day of the final, I had to stand in and we won as part of the Nicolson Institute team. And it's such a long time ago. We heard a lot about the internet, but we didn't even have the internet back then. So we had to go to the library and go through the microfilms to look at the newspaper. So I don't know if it's easier today, but the research was a little bit easier. Is a little bit easier, definitely. But I remember how nervous I was that day, standing and talking. So congratulations to both teams. And I think Alistair should just watch out, otherwise somebody here might be stealing our jobs in a few years. It was a very good subject, and on behalf of the BBC, congratulations to Megan. Congratulations on your victory. Congratulations, Megan. And congratulations, Dingwall Academy. Thank you very much to all the teams that took part in this year's competition. Thank you to our judges who were present tonight, to BT Scotland, those who are here present in the Scottish Parliament, and also those of you who are listening to us on Radio Ningale. From myself and everybody here, good night.